Oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. Oh, this woman cried and the Lord heard it. And the Lord saved him and the Lord delivered him from all his fears. Such God is the case before us this morning. Many are the afflictions of your people, but you deliver them from all their fears. We pray in the name of Jesus, the one who hears, the one who delivers, the one that moves to the rescue of his children, the Almighty God. We pray even now in the name of Jesus that you will touch your children. I pray, God, you will touch my brother. You know exactly where he's at. You know the challenges that he faces. You know the mountain that seems, oh God, that he cannot conquer them on his own. But I pray in the name of Jesus, you will take him, God, from his lowly bar. You will exalt him at the mountain top. You will shut the mouth of the lions that surround him. And oh God, you will allow the enemies to know that one more time you deliver us. I pray, Almighty God, for every person this morning that comes with a situation, God, and the feelings and pain of themselves, God, have failed, and they can't do anything else, oh God, on their own. I pray, God, for their strength. I pray, God, that they will cast their cares on you, God, because I know you care for them. I pray, God, though the waters may seem up to their necks and seem to be going under, God, just as how you found the Red Sea, you will speak to the wind and the waves that surround them, God, and you will carry them through in the name of Jesus Christ, Nazareth. I ask you, Almighty God, that you will get into the deep intricacies of the circumstances that surround your children. Father, many are here out of need. Many are here because of necessity. Many are here because of great engagement. But God, our verse is also true. Many are here this morning, God, because their house of their lives are in turmoil. Many are here, God, because they feel the things are slipping beneath them. And God, that we should hope for, it seems as if they can't make it, or they will not be able, oh God, to grasp it. But in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth today, I pray, Almighty God, that you will rest your hand upon your children. I pray that you will rescue them, Almighty God. I pray that you will bring them up, and I pray that you will bring them over. And the world is very many for the affliction of the righteous. But my God, you have delivered them before, and we know that you can deliver again. So we shall not be God. Whatever shape it comes. them and allow them to know that I am here and you have delivered one with time. I bless you today. I pray for the peace of God over you. I pray for the healing power of Almighty God to reach you, to suffer in your life. I pray, God, for those who are unable to be here, who are going through their deep waters. I speak peace over you. I speak a blessing of the Lord God over you. I pray that the hand of God will rest upon you. I pray that he will turn it around for you in the name of Jesus.
God is bigger than all of your situations. In fact, he reminds us that we'll cast all our cares on him because he what? He cares for us. Just touch your neighbor and tell your neighbor, he cares.
He cares.
Just tell somebody's neighbor, Jesus cares. Just touch somebody behind you and say, hey neighbor, guess what? He cares. Tell somebody, I know he cares. Somebody give him praise in the house. Somebody give him praise in the house. Deacon Smith, who is back in the saddle again, who has been away for a little while, not well, but God has brought him safe thus far, and we celebrate with him. To all our visiting friends, brothers and sisters, I want to extend to you Christian greetings in Jesus' name. To the choir that ministered to us a while ago, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fears are gone. Just because I know he holds the future, my life is worth in living just because he lives. And to those of you who are watching us by way of Facebook, welcome. And the Lord God bless you. I trust that you will receive a word from the Lord. Amen? God sent his son. They call him Jesus. He came to heal, love and forgive. The 22nd chapter, and we look at verse 1 to just about a few other verses. Isaiah 22, verse 1. The burden of the valley of vision. What a life be now, that thou art wholly gone up to the housetops, thou that art full of tears. A tumultuous city, joyous city. They slain men are not slain with the sword, nor dead in battle. All they that rulers are fled together. They are bound by the archers. All that are found in thee are bound together, which have fled from far. Therefore said I, look away from me, I will weep bitterly, labor not to comfort me, because of the spoiling of the daughter of my people. For it is a day of trouble, and treading down, and of perplexity by the Lord God of hosts, in the valley of vision, breaking down the walls, and carrying to the mountains, and Elam bear the quiver with chariots of men and horsemen, and cur and cover the shield. Verse 7, and it shall come to pass that the chastised valley shall be full of chariots, and the horsemen shall set themselves in array at the gate. We honor the word by saying, amen. Amen. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, it's time to weep for Jamaica. Tell somebody else again, neighbor, it's time to weep for Jamaica. Father, in Jesus' name, bless your people. Let your words go forth with clarity and power today. In Jesus' name, amen. I try not to preach, but I will just try to share with you. As physically I'm not well, but I'm trusting God that by the end I get to the next paragraph, my helper will come. And if you pray for me, the word will go forth. Amen? Amen. My brothers and sisters, I have never claimed to be a prophet. But there comes a time in the life of every preacher when the word of God becomes such a fire in his bones. I have to speak out what I see happening in our island. I am duty bound to tell you what God has put on my heart concerning this rock called Jamaica. I do believe God has true prophets, those who are occasionally moved upon by the Holy Spirit to foretell future events and coming judgment. Indeed, my brothers and sisters, turn me back up. On a few rare occasions, the Spirit of God has compelled me to warn of impending judgment that is coming to our nation. But the prophecy I bring to you now is not predictive prophecy. Rather, I want to take you straight into the Word to show you a few eternal principles of how the Lord works, and for any Bible student can know how God intends to deal with Jamaica, or for that matter, any nation, by studying the history and patterns of God's working in the Old Testament. We can know the future by studying the past. My friend, the fact is, God's ways are absolutely unchangeable when it comes to the dealings with the sinful nation. There is no shadow of turning in his way. His works the same way in every single generation, from the time of my foreparents until the time of my birth, and even up to this time. He is indeed a just God. In short, he will deal with our generation in the same way he has dealt with every other generation that sinned as we are sinning today. And by learning these eternal principles of his ways from scripture, we can deduct exactly how he will deal with us today. For example, my friend, the Apostle Paul predicted, even to the Corinthians church, what would happen to them if they continue to tempt the Lord. Those Christians were mourning and giving themselves over to unreligious things such as lust. So Paul simply looked into history and saw what God did to Israel when they committed the very same sins. Paul told the Corinthians, neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempt and were destroyed by the serpents. Neither mourn ye, as some of them also mourn and were destroyed
of the destroyer. Now all these things, my friend, happen unto them for simple reason, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come. 1 Corinthians 10 verse 9 through to 11. The apostle was saying, this is a clear pattern in scripture. It tells you what God will do to you if you continue to sin as Israel has sinned. The apostle Peter also warned his readers by invoking an example from the Old Testament. He said God would judge them for their covetousness and unbridled lust, just as he had judged past generations, and turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes. God did that. Condemned them with an overthrow, making them an example unto those that after would live ungodly. According to 2 Peter 2 verse 6, Peter warned, if you sin as Sodom and Gomorrah did, the Lord will destroy you just as he has destroyed them. Like Paul and Peter, I bring to you today a warning based on my study of the Old Testament, especially the book of Isaiah. As I read through this book recently, the Spirit stopped me in chapter 22. Suddenly, I began to see how judgment can come upon Jerusalem in Isaiah's day. In spite of all the promised warning, according to Isaiah 22, contained a shocking account of a society that had sinned away in day of grace. Church of Jerusalem and Judea had crossed a line that they should not have crossed, and there was no turning back. The people had backslidden completely and were living as though they were atheists. So the Bible said God instructed Isaiah to prophesy to his people, to pronounce a death release of judgment upon the nation. You see, my friend, God's call to repentance in Judea over at was over. There would no longer be a prophetic voice in the land crying, return and be healed. No, it was too late. This people done something so brazen. God could not endure it one more day. Carefully, my friend, with a crushed heart, Isaiah brought this awful message, and it was revealed in my ears by the Lord of hosts. He says, surely this iniquity shall not be purged from you till you die, saith the Lord of hosts. Isaiah 22 verse 14. He was saying, in essence, you have committed a sin that God won't forgive. You have crossed a line, and it's too late to turn back. It's time for the church to weep for Jamaica, because the judgment of God is about to release upon the land that he had given to us. My friend, when you fully understand what this society did to provoke God to release them to judgment, you will see that their action mirrors Jamaica society today. What Jerusalem and Judea did to bring judgment upon themselves is exactly what Jamaica is doing as I speak. And if the wicked behavior of God's people signal, amen, to stop, you must turn and face the other way. Then our sinful behavior clearly signal the death throes of our nation. If the prophet Isaiah were living today in Jamaica, beholding the wickedness of our nation, he would cry out, it's time to weep for your nation. History, my friend, is repeating itself. Your crop, your cup of iniquity is full and it's overflowing. Chapter 22 of Isaiah is called the Valley of Visions. Isaiah message here is so clear, so easy to understand, there can be no doubt about its meaning. According to the commentators, Isaiah was evidently standing aiming on a rooftop or some oversight of high elevation, looking down over Jerusalem, amen, and the surrounding valley. What he saw was so appalling, it breaks his heart. He wept, amen, conclusively, saying to all who pass by, look away, don't you look at me. I will weep bitterly, labor not to comfort me. In other words, don't try to console me because of the spoiling of the daughters of my people. In verse 4, my brothers and sisters, as a priest of the flock of God, when I stand and look over the country called Jamaica, there has been some very appalling things that is taking place in our land. Before we get into our land, let us deal with the church, because the church is going to speak with a moral voice of authority. The church must first get her house in order. The church must first get her act together. The church must not turn from her wicked ways and turn back to God. You know, I like what I'm talking about today, but God is very wrong with our people and angry with our nation. The people have gone back in their ancestral, amen, way of living. We're finally living with family. Hello, Church of God, where fornication becomes the order of the day, where adultery is a part of our church, where bestiality and other working and witchcraft working and palm reading is a part of our church. God said, if my people are going to speak with a voice of authority, then my people need to cleanse herself before they can speak. The church need a purging. Oh, somebody don't want me to talk here today, but the church must get back her act together, or my people who are called by night will humble themselves and seek my face and what? Turn from their wicked ways. Put your brother beside you and tell him it's time to turn. Put your sister beside you and tell him it's time to turn. The church needs to clean up from the rust, from to the pew, from the vestry to the pulpit. The church need a purging. The people of God need to get back to the place where they can come down on their pumps and their pride. Or somebody want to talk the truth here today. The church need to come back again and humble herself. Preacher need to clean up their houses. Baker need to clean up their houses. Musician need to clean up themselves. Members need to clean up themselves. Visitors come into the house of God to clean up themselves. Church night is coming, if the people will not turn. Hello, somebody, it's time to leave in the house and in the quarters.
I'm sorely pained, and I can't take it any longer.
My people are about to be destroyed. My heart pounded fearful. Amen. Fearfulness. My lines are weak. Amen. He said, pain is running through me. In chapter 21, verse 4 and 3. This clearing, my friend, amen, was a picture of him and Isaiah's part. It was a burden of the Lord. Here is a picture of a man broken over his society's sin. Sometimes we don't often see in our church, amen, there simply aren't many pastors or Christians in Jamaica who see Jamaica coming, amen, and who are broken over it. Yet for a long time, Isaiah had been speaking of a vision of judgment he had received from the Lord. He had foreseen a huge army, amen, contingent of chariots, amen, coming towards the Jerusalem. He sees powerful horsemen and camels. All he said coming against the city. Now Isaiah's prophetic vision was unfolding before his very eyes. Enemy armies had surrounded Jerusalem. A siege was on the way. Amen. The noise of military movement echoes over the hills. The terrible farm horsemen of Elam and hand-to-hand fighters of Kerr. Amen. Were marching in the very trenches. War horses. Amen. Groaning and heartbeat and hoofs pounding on the earth. My friend, when I look at chapter 22, Isaiah, I look over the city of Montego Bay. I hear a lot of scamming. I see murder. I see sorcery. Amen. I see all kind of things happening. The government pray. The nation pray. Amen. But then the armies came in and they besieged the entire city of Montego Bay because something horrible is going on in our nation. My brothers and sisters, sit back and say it's a state of emergency. Every man, woman, boy, and girl need to holler, need to weep, need to cry, need to follow up our nation. My friend, bloodshed is running in the way that our young men are turning to the gun. Our young girls are turning to letter scanning. Our grandparents are turning to opia, working something gone wrong in our nation. The people need to come back to Almighty God. There must be a holy repentance. There must be a weeping for our nature. We must seek the face of Almighty God. We must pray for our troops and believe for God. Amen. That he will give them the wisdom that they will not leave one stone in Montego Bay that is unturned until we get every lack of scammer. Amen. Whether they are in the business sector, whether they are in the private sector, whether they are in local government, or they are in central government, we must stand up and say enough is enough. Jamaica needs a revival. We need a revival, and it's time for the church to weep for our land. Isaiah was incredulous at what he saw. He cried out, "Thou that art full of tears and tumultuous city," he said, "a joyous city." Chapter 22, verse 2. All this time the prophet had been walking up and down the land, warning God's people, "Your idols will be brought down." The city walls in which you trust will be breached. Your glory shall fade. Time, he says, is running out. Yet how did the people react? They jostled each other on the rooftop, trying to get the best view of approaching enemy. The whole city was packed, stirred up, full of excitement, joy and abundance. Yet the Bible used a word here that means boisterous, loud and excited. People who are dwelling, amen, were closed off and they could not come out. Isaiah was saying the enemy is going to come in like a flood, and he's going to capture the nation. Your enemies will besiege you, he says, unless the people turn from their ways and turn back to Almighty God. My friend, if my people who are called by the name of the Lord will turn, the church need to cry out to God for Jamaica and let God arise in our nation and let freedom reign again. Amen. From Murray Bay to Nickel Point. Amen. Church of God, from Montego Bay. Amen. To Jamaica House. We need God to take back reign over our nation, Jamaica.
Today, what allies our nation and society? How can our whole nation party, dance, drink with all kind of excitement while a hundred of our young ladies and men, babies, are being brutally gunned down in our streets? What horrible sickness allows our society to continue meddle and meddle in the sort of kind of atrocities acted out to our people? Why the elderlies are dying because of what happened to them in the 1990s? Jamaica is under siege by an army of abortionists in our nation. Jamaica is under siege by a group of pornographers, drug pushers, murderers. Amen. We are under siege by some politicians who have hijacked our government. We are under siege by some pastors who wear long gowns. Amen. Who refuse to preach the shed the Lord. We are under siege by those who paid the church for a guide and still are involved in some things that are not of God. God said I'm going to walk down in Jamaica House. I'm going to walk down in the church houses. I'm going to walk down in the communities. I'm going to walk down in the valleys. I'm going to purge my nation because my people have turned from me. I ask you again, where are those who grieve for Jamaica? Where are those who are broken over the sins of God's church and of our nation? Consider that statement that has been made by a former national security minister that many lashing for, that Jamaica needs God. Consider what the present one says and how some react. Amen. My brothers and sisters, when it comes down to crime and violence and extortionists and murder in our land, it isn't a political thing. It doesn't have any green or yellow. It is a national thing, and it's time for us to be mature, whether you're labor right or your PhD, and stand up for what is right in Jamaica land we love. We need to get back to the place where we take our colors and let God be glorified in our land. But the citizens, the Texans of Jerusalem, they became accustomed to the plague. They became hardened to the death all around them. So much so that they could entertain themselves on rooftops while just below them people were dying. They carelessly waited, wasted the city, because of their pleasure. I asked you again, doesn't this sound awfully familiar? Yes. Isn't it a picture of Jamaica in degeneration? Amen. But I believe something even worse could happen to this nation. Because of something I see in Isaiah 22. Suppose the awful flesh-eating illness called Ebola strike with fury in Jamaica. This is a flesh-eating disease that can kill a person within a week.
or perhaps one of the newly discovered exotic diseases being able to suck out life by just a second. My brothers and sisters, I believe what happened in the past can happen again. Our country would be devastated. Let me share something with you that I discovered just putting this together. In October 8, 1851, Dr. Perkins, amen, put out a paper in the London publication where 40,000 Jamaicans killed, 40,000 out of 400,000 in 1851. You know what plague it was? It was a plague that many of you, including myself, in Africa, in 1851, cholera broke out from Niguel Point straight to Jamaica, to Moran Point. And 40,000 Jamaicans were killed. That was a dangerous thing. My friend, what I see happen in history, I see repeating itself again. I see too much young men dying before they reach 70. I see too many young girls dying before they reach 30. I see too many unborn babies dying before they leave the womb. Something worse than Ebola. Something worse than cholera is taking over our land. It is called AK-47. Amen. It is called 9mm semi-automatic automatic pistol. It has different names. That is taking over our land. Too many guns are in our nation. Too many guns are in our community. Too many young men have to die before somebody stand up and say enough is enough. When are we going to stand up as a nation? When are we going to say, see, your God cannot be a community with so many guns? When are we going to say, our young girls must strive and live and graduate and go to university? When are we going to say, our young boys must finish school? I was this committee yesterday. And I find something shocking. After we leave church, after they went through cleaning, and I begin to walk, I stop, and I spoke to several young men. One was 29 years old. Many of them was in their late 20s, and they couldn't read. And they want to know how they can get help. I said, the first place to turn to is Jesus Christ. I said, the second thing is to come to Sunday school so they can learn to read and write. And I share my experience with a couple of them on the street. I said, when I leave high school in 94, I could not read and write. So when you're pastor now, I said, yes, that's because I did something to turn my misfortune around. I got sick of going to school. And I sent back myself to school. I said, you can do the same. What is happening today is that young persons are leaving school and drop out of school, and when they do, they drop out the corner and they dig out their hand middle. And every friend that they say, boy, buy me a drink, buy me a food. And they say, one dog, buy me something, no? It's time for you to get out of the dog kind of mentality and call yourself a human being and say, I have won for myself. I shall not go down on my grandparents, but I shall be like a tree that is planted by the rivers of water that bringeth its fruit in its season. Its leaves also shall not wither, and whatsoever it do shall being. I said, what the dog? And I hear some of them boom boom. Brethren, you can laugh over these things. But whatever you think of yourself, that is what you shall become. Then I shall not die in my lowly bar. I shall not go under in the way of the scourge of fire.
having abortion. 12 years old. Mother, boyfriend, playing with them. And nobody now say nothing about it. Nobody think it's serious. Come on, blood touch blood. If you have a girlfriend, don't let the boyfriend trouble your daughter. Don't let them trouble your son. It's time for us to leave for Jamaica. Something's gone wrong. We have lost our moral compass. It's time for us to get it back.
I know I make some of you uncomfortable right now. But it's not only that. You have Christian have no principle. They cuss any enemy and want any old home. Some of them want to let it come for each other. It's time for us to break out of that way and allow the people of community to see Jesus in you.
It's time for us to get it right in the church. It's time for us to get it right in our communities. It's time for us to get it right in Jamaica. On the contrary, my friend, Jamaica would be swamped with the most wild and believable origins of species from the different land. If the church refuses to stand up for what is right. I warn for the church and the people of God to become perplexed in your spirit and decide that enough is enough. I will fight for the soul of my country. God in his mercy made one last attempt to save Jerusalem. And I believe he's making another attempt to save Jamaica. This is what he says in verse 8. The Lord sent his spirit upon the people while they were partying. While they were what? Suddenly, their eyes were open to the danger that they were in. And he discovered the covering of Judea. We are not told exactly what happened when the Holy Spirit came down and interrupt their party. We don't know if anyone went to the temple to pray, or if anyone went to Isaiah and asked what to do. But the problem was a brief period when the people at least thought of God and said a few prayers. Deep inside, they knew God's hand was in this judgment. My friend, I believe that God is going to open the eyes of this nation. I believe it has started with our national day of prayer and repentance. I believe it continue with our national prayer breakfast. I believe it continue with the church in our 21 days of fasting. I believe it continues in our home and our personal spaces. And I believe that the veil is going to be pulled back. And people are going to understand who they are and what they're about. I believe God is not through with Jamaica. I believe there's more, as the Governor General said, there's more that is right with Jamaica than what is wrong with Jamaica. I believe that the majority of us are good people. It's just a handful. It's time now for good to push back against evil. It's time for the righteous to stand up and to speak up. It is time for the righteous to say what they see and do something towards it. What triggered God's dread released for the society is because the people refuse to turn. For us today, Jamaica is in a state
that we have never seen it since the 1600s.
Mark you, we say that crime is rampant in Jamaica, and there was a time when Jamaica was not like this. But your history will tell you, Jamaica was never a place without violence. It was never. It was since 2001 that we become the murder capital of the world. It happened in the 1800s when God sent the entire city of Port Royal. God, I believe, is going to do something drastic again. And when it does, just like Port Royal has never recovered from its city status, Jamaica is going to feel if they don't repent. And for those of us who understand our past, we must use our past to teach us the future. And let God arise in our land. What final indignation awaits us? What brief act set God's judgment into motion? What was Israel's iniquity that triggered the judgment? What made God say, that's enough? No, you cross the line. Isaiah gave us the answer. And in that day did the Lord God of hosts call to weeping and mourning and a blindness and a girding and sackcloth, and behold, joy and gladness, slaying oxen, killing sheep, eating flesh and drinking wine. Let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we shall die. Even in the midst of their brazen rebellion, God's Spirit was calling people to repentance. Up to the very end, the holy cry was heard in the street. Weep, mourn, put on sackcloth and ash. But instead of mourning, the people parted. Instead of grieving and weeping, they revealed with food and wine. They reasoned by themselves, but this time tomorrow, we'll all be dead. What should we learn from this? That rebellion doesn't pay. So when you say, go and eat, drink, and be merry, because tomorrow doesn't promise to anyone, you're flying in the face of God, as were the children of Judea. My friend, tomorrow is promised as long as God is on his throne. You don't have to face tomorrow with uncertainties. You can face your tomorrows with joy, knowing that God is on your side. And you can say like others, had it not been for the Lord who is on my side, then tell me, where would I be? It's time for us to weep for our nation. It's time for us to weep for our young men and our young women. It's time for us to weep for each other and our church and our government and our security forces. And say, God, in your wrath, have mercy. And your righteous call unto God, God will spare a nation. But can God find 10 of us to call upon him? Can he find 50? They are more than the numbers. Let us now take the heed and weep for our nation and ask God for revival. And if you pray tonight, if you pray today, if I pray tomorrow, if all of us continue to do this, I believe God can turn this country around. I said I believe that last year, that this year, crime will fall. And somebody said to me, but Pastor, since the year, the year started, over 130 persons already lost their lives. I said, things have to get worse before they get better. But I am of that conviction that this year murder rate must go under what we saw last year. I believe that there must be a sense of urgency in every one of us part to make that happen. Act justly. Walk righteously with your God. And if you do that, I see Jamaica being a better place than it currently is today. If you look back, two things that made Jamaica shine years ago. Our export and our people. When we come together, the people again, Jamaica will shine. But too many of us become too gluttonous, too greedy, and cover corruption. You know that the boys in Lamb's cabin, you know that they kill, but yet you partake of what they're part of. How can our society be better? It's time for us to put a stop by making our actions known and our attitude seen that I am for justice, truth, and rightness. We'll just go ahead where you're at. Can you just hold on to the person by you? We're going to pray right now. Father, in Jesus' name we give you honor, we give you praise, we give you glory. Lord, we have learned from our history. And we know that we have never been a people who are always peacemakers. We are a religious people. But Lord, we have turned far from your principles and your laws and your command. Hence, our homes are in turmoil. Our communities, and by extension, our nation. But as a people today, we cry to thee to have mercy on Jamaica that we love. We ask God you will lift the scourge of the thirst for blood and let peace reign one more time. I pray, God, that we will be able to cultivate the attitude and habit for work rather than the get-well mentality. Help us to work. As it said, by the sweat of our brows, we shall be bread. Help us to put away the knives, the gun, the witchcraft, and to love each other as you have loved us. Lord, help us not only to be our own keepers of our homes, but to be our brothers and sisters' keepers. That, Lord, as we look over our own biological families, we'll also look for our neighbor's children. We are one community. And so, God, I pray that the judgment that is over our nation, we intercede now, God. We ask you to lift the scourge. We ask, oh God, that we will once again walk in peace and harmony and not in fear of our lives, but to know that you are in control again. From this pulpit today, to our families here, and by extension, the wider community, Jamaica land we love, we pray for the peace of our nation. We pray, God, you'll open the eyes of the young men who are now using embalming fluids to commit serious acts. We pray, God, for those who have been converted from witchcraft working and now testifying the thing that they did. Pull back the veil again a little further. We drive your spirit away in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And we ask Almighty God that the demons that have been unleashed over the 14 parishes of Jamaica, cage them in the blood of the Lamb of God, and let peace reign again. May the fear of God flow in our homes and our churches again. May Jamaica experience a break, oh God, from the scourge of crime and violence. May Jamaica, under God, increase in beauty, fellowship, and prosperity. May God, you stand with our nation as we stand with you. May you stand with the security forces who at times seem, oh God, as if they have no clue how
discouraged. But may the men and the women who serve you in the Jamaica Defense Force, in the Jamaica Constabulary Force, may you give them wisdom, may you give them vision, may you promote them, oh God, so they can push back against these kind of crime that we have seen in our nation, Jamaica. We need you, God, to rescue our nation. We need you to get into the hospitals and into the private sectors. And oh God, we put your entire things around in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Spirit of the living God, may your love and your peace rest upon us. We back every evil forces that push against us. We nullify them. We trample them. We plead the blood of Jesus Christ of Nazareth over them. And we just wrap them up and send them to dark places in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And we're speaking life over Jamaica. Life over our young girls. Life over our young men. I pray, God, whatever spirit has captivated their mind and their spirit, release them by your power in the name of Jesus. And let this mind which be in Christ be also in our young men. Can the church of God travail with me just 2 more minutes? Can somebody stand in solidarity with us? And we claim our young men for Jamaica. And we claim our young girls for Jamaica. And we push back against the crime and the violence. And we push back against the bloodshed and the mayhem and the diseases that are coming in our land. And we push back against the dark forces. We claim victory in the name of Jesus. We shut up on the scorpions and the serpents that are rising against us.
Hallelujah.